Good evening and a very warm welcome to Dorset Humanists, especially if you're a visitor or if this is your first time. It's great to see you. In the unlikely event of an emergency, the main way out of here is the door at the back of the hall, which takes you straight out into the car park. If you're very athletic, there is also quite a steep steps here out of the window, but the main one is at the back there. There are toilets in the corridor if you need them at any time, and our meeting will end no later than 9:15, but you don't have to rush away. Do please hang around, have a chat, and normally there's a gang of people from our group who go up to the bar, you know, they should be friendly, but you know, if you just gatecrash in on their meeting. And if they say they don't know anything about humanism, you've probably got some other group, but anyway. But hopefully it'll be fairly obvious who we are. Good, well, our speaker tonight is currently a course leader for the U3A, which is University of the Third Age, which is, I'm very worried, I think that even includes me now. He's a part-time teacher at Bournemouth School for Girls. Now, do we have any BSG, current or ex-BSG girls here tonight? Oh, yes, we do. Oh, okay. At least one. Okay.
Half the BSG mafia.
Oh, mafia, yes.
They are people who were pupils there, and then ended up on the staff because they knew too much.
They ended up on the staff. Right, okay. Well, both my sister and my mum told you BSG as well. Okay, well, our speaker tonight has taught for over 35 years in the Dorset area, mostly English and English literature, but also in the days when schools believed in a broader education than they do now, the history of English architecture, when he used to deliver a sixth form, 8-week crash course on site in Christchurch, Wimborne, Poole and Bournemouth with the help of a former school minibus. John's interest in buildings was sparked, believe it or not, by the old children's programme Thunderbirds, in which Lady Penelope's house used to form a backdrop to her startling pink Rolls Royce. I only remember the Rolls Royce, actually. It was actually very closely modelled on Stowe in Wiltshire. Much reading, visiting and looking followed over the years, and at one stage John undertook several months' research in the William Banks archive at Dorchester. He's delivered talks to other groups on Kingston Lacy and the buildings at Bournemouth, and the paper he presents tonight is, I'm assured, something of an overview of many strands of building history. So will you please give John Hubbard a very warm welcome.
Thank you very much, David. If it's all right with you, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to talk for about 50 minutes and we'll have questions at the end. I'm going to start with a statement of the amazingly obvious. Buildings are so much bigger than we are. They demand attention, and one of the ways we repay this impertinent insistence is by failing to notice them. And I'd like to try, when I do talk on architecture, this simple little test with details of some of the better-known parts of Bournemouth's built environment. So, see if you can spot or recognise any of those two. Any of us? Town Hall, right, and the Abbey Life of the Wedding Cake building. And we can talk about nicknames for buildings later on as well. Right, try these two, a bit more difficult. Sort of right era. If I said department stores to you, would that help?
Yes,
Beale's bottom right and House of Fraser top left. And these two? Russell Coates. And on the right?
Royal Bath Hotel.
The front door here.
Yes, it's the front door of the building in Wilton. The thing is, they're also conditioned to place great value on some structures, greater value on some structures than others, particularly those that have accrued a huge amount of cultural capital. Take, for example, this local treasure house with its millions of pounds worth of paintings behind its walls. a building that was refashioned by the same architect as the house I'm about to show you, Charles Barry, and I'm sure you're going to tell me where that is. Well, actually, it's not Downton Abbey, it's Highclere Castle. But that's the point I wanted to make, because there's another layering of our reading of buildings brought to us by television and film drama's constant search for suitable locations for what they want to deliver to the general public. It's in fact Lord Carnarvon's home, not Lord Grantham's. Yet, these grand palaces have in common with all houses considerations of space, shape, materials and cost. And the decisions made that we witness in local streets as well contribute no less to the aesthetic value of a house and the pleasure we may derive from passing it and living in it. Interestingly, I think, we don't really conceive of our own homes as a manifestation of our animal nature, though we use them to some extent in much the same way as birds and mammals do. Platforms from which to launch the young into the world, or to provide shelter. What we do notice, though, is that our spaces fit us considerably less like a glove. This is no more true when we consider our technological skill and how, even from earliest times, it has allowed us in certain circumstances to distort our building's relationships to ourselves in scale. And that could be through worship of gods or rank or power or money. The biblical measures so closely associated with the body, the cubit and the span, are multiplied as far as mathematics and materials will allow to acknowledge greater forces, be they religious, social, or economic in their dimension. Just take these. That's from the 6th century BC, when buildings were held together with an ingenious system of brass pegs. You could have a look at this one, which is the lofty heights of Amiens Cathedral, which was about 139 feet, the height of the nave. Many French cathedrals from this era, because they hadn't quite perfected the technology of the flying buttress, occasionally collapsed at the concluding point of their construction. You'll be more familiar perhaps with this one, with Salisbury Cathedral. And yet, this multiplication of scale, this extraordinary dwarfing of the human being, and if you consider what kind of houses people were living in at the beginning of the 13th century from which these buildings come, you get the real sense of that distortion. And yet, to some extent, there is a bit of the human scale in Christian buildings, not least because the ground plan did match something of a human scale, although enlarged. There are also extraordinary palaces like this. This is Stowe in Buckinghamshire, which speaks volumes of the power of the Dukes of Buckingham and Chandos, which they rather diminished by being a little reckless in gambling, so that by 1923 it had become a private school. Here's, which I think another place you'll know through television, the Cranford series. This is West Wickham Park in Buckinghamshire. Have a look inside, and although this is the central entrance hall in Stowe, the assembly hall, to humanise it, they've got full human-sized statues, and the doors themselves, although lofty, have minor parts of them which open, which are more in scale with ourselves. If you go to West Wickham Park, you will notice that a dado rail, a lower wooden panelling, the furniture, bring things closer to our sense of our ordinary humanity. Then let's consider money and the world of the office. You'll probably know the Flatiron Building on the left-hand side, 1902, one of the first skyscrapers built in Manhattan. And on the right, a wonderful modern collection of buildings which all had particular nicknames. The walkie-talkie, the gherkin, the cheese grater. That's rather dully called now, I think, Tower 52 or 42, I forget. And this was taken from a building called the Shard. And yet, although things are piled up because they have to be used by multiple office workers going in and out, the individual floors themselves have a recognisable headroom and seem more to scale. This is the inside of the gherkin, and this is the inside of the walkie-talkie. But to be fair, grandeur can also ennoble fine, secular human activity, and it's not without pomp. This is a wonderful early Victorian building, which just goes to show Victorian architecture is not all Gothic. George Posebe's Fitzwilliam Museum, and something that is very decidedly Gothic from the 1870s, you may recognise that as Alfred Waterhouse's Manchester Town Hall. So architecture was able to dignify civic activity. But I think fully to understand the human scale in architecture, we need to turn to domestic space and the way we use it, and explore that nexus of building as a static place, our individual mobility as visually aware animals, and the collection of the objects and possessions within. The material culture of the home could really be called a museum of the self. And it's no less revealing if you live in a cottage or in a palace. There's a delightful Hardy short story called Old Mrs. Chundle, and she tells her naive new curate about the geographical scope of her life from the village, probably Kingston near Corfe, in which she's lived 35 years. Once a fortnight, she goes to Anglebury, Wareham, to do her bit of marketing, which is all of 7 miles distant, and that's the furthest she ever travels. The great house at Encombe, 3 miles away, she sees no point of venturing to, because the grand people there she has have as little in common with her as the people on the moon. It's locality that often makes for the scale and the connection and the harmony of vernacular building. I just want to think of our local area for the minute. Let's take the New Forest cottage. Cob walls and thatch. Now, cob is an extraordinary mixture of lime, sand. We lived in a New Forest cottage when I grew up, and I know from picking at the walls that it also included sheep's wool, dung, straw, and almost anything else you could get your hands on. And the fondness for this original material is shown by this rather strange lump on a more modern house, where they were insistent on keeping that piece of the original wall. If you go to West Dorset, around Abbotsbury, you get this lovely creamy stone. Go to North Dorset, near the Somerset border, up towards the Handstone area there, and in a place like Sherborne, you will get buildings of this richer, more orange colour. Down in the Stour Valley, you will get buildings made from the flints gathered from the chalk downland above them, and brick. And it weathers beautifully. But in places like the Isle of Purbeck, the stone is slightly greyer, and there is a fondness for stone roofs as well. But the harmony of towns and villages, all grown out of the local environment, is very, very apparent. But you can see how the environment has been damaged to an extent with the increase of transport technology. The improvements in canals and then railways and finally roads widen the scope for the availability of materials and increase the strangeness of things with a village. Inharmonious, bright red brick. Sometimes reconstituted stone. Don't get me on bungalows in Dorset, going on bungalows in Dorset villages. Sea transport had always been a wonderful, easy form if you had quarries near enough, and it was responsible for another kind of scalar distortion in terms of the distance and the gathering of material to the completion of the finished product. It was what was responsible for what we might call Dorset's most famous export. It was transformation of lumps of the great block at the top right there into that. Now, once free of the restrictions of local materials, builders and designers were able to create for their commissioners as they wish. And I'm going to take a few local examples to show you the two ways they seem to want to go. You can go for the nostalgic, what I would call a kind of new retro. Here's an example of someone trying to imitate an Edwardian gentleman's home. Or this rather lovely example of a kind of Jacobean revival that's been constructed in the Branston Park area in the last 3 years and designed by a wonderful architectural practice in Christchurch. Then you can go in the modern direction. Seven developments are responsible, I think, for both of these houses, which suggests a willingness to be untrammeled by some old decorative traditions, deliberately looking forward, being confident, but perhaps to some extent slightly insensitive to context. The statement house that pays no heed of neighbours, that tends perhaps to be isolationist instead of communal. And following those traditions, you get two styles of interior, the old and the new. I expect you've all seen pictures of Victorian interiors, that multiplicity of amiable clutter. If you've been around in Bournemouth as long as I have, you may remember the Russell Coates Museum before they tidied it up a bit. And there was just so much stuff there, you could hardly find your way around. But there are these two traditions. One is a kind of country house tradition, the sort of Osborne and Little style home with materials harmoniously deployed, lots of tables, lots of objects. And it seems to have a kind of personality to it. And that you could contrast with rather more minimalist interiors, which effaces almost the human within the house. It's as if you know people less if you go into that kind of home. You probably don't feel quite as relaxed or comfortable, and that's not just because all modern sofas seem to be peculiarly unyielding. If you have resources to build for yourself, your home's exterior presents a facet of you to the world. But for most of us, our house shapes are a given. We buy or rent a place whose design we have had no part of, but to which we do bring our own strategies of personalisation and display. As we come and go from our home daily, so others will visit on a less regular and short-term basis, and we accommodate our home to them, but we are aware that it communicates something of us. And here is the truth of the domestic environment. They are dominantly private, but yet we want to show them to people to whom we extend hospitality. We are, thank heaven, under no obligation to extend largesse beyond a friendship group with unlimited means. We are content with our homely privacy. Yet, for a long time, with the great house, the tradition of hospitality was much more open. The country house poems by Ben Jonson and Andrew Marvell of the 17th century, to Penshurst, the garden upon Appleton House, for example, celebrated an almost limitless abundance and fertility that is the implied reward of public virtue and generosity. Yet it was of a much more inclusive kind than many believe, through the focus of television drama on Victorian and post-Victorian households, where the servants and the privileged lived almost entirely separate lives. Yet this was not always so. Up to the end of the 16th century, in many noble houses, service functions closest to the family were often performed by the sons of those of gentle birth from the local area, learning the ways of the court. Those of you who may remember that Chaucer's Merchant's Tale from your school days will remember that January's treacherous squire, Damian, carved before his master at the table. The only place in which this noble servant role still exists is around the sovereign, the queen and her ladies in waiting. And I'll come back to the sovereign a bit here and there. This is Athelhampton, and on the right you can see the entrance door and the old hall area. And the hall looks like this. It's got a dais at the top end and what's called the screens passage at the bottom, which goes straight out to the front door. Now, this arrangement was for the hall to be the communal eating area for everybody in the household. It remains true in Oxford and Cambridge colleges, the halls of city guilds, and the inns of court. In the lower part, practitioners, servants, lesser visitors, students, legal trainees, and liverymen sat beneath the dais. Nowadays, if we use the word hall, we tend to imply some rather inferior entrance place where you might wipe your feet and hang your coat. It contains no longer any sense of feasting hospitality. Because from around 1600 onwards, families decided it would be a good idea to dine alone in a room apart. Now, in older houses too, servants were held less at a distance. Before the technology of bell pulls and wires had come, they had to attend within earshot, hovering close during the day and sleeping close at night. Too close observers for comfort, perhaps. But then, life was generally lived less privately, and the concept of personal privacy was rather different, if it existed at all. When Kingston Lacy was built, the roof space was probably a large dormitory for house servants. Small shared rooms were inserted over time. It's worth bearing in mind that in the 1660s, and probably for at least 150 years more after that, it was an era in which, in houses, and particularly in inns, sharing beds was a norm. A place that a travelling inn could well mean half a bed with a stranger in it already snoring. In grand houses like Bremer, large rooms might have two curtain beds in them. The story of the great house from the late 17th century onwards was one that moved towards separation and closed gates rather than open ones. You'll probably recognise this rather grand William Chambers mansion, Milton Abbey. And villages, which had once been amiably cheek by jowl with a large local manor house, were removed, lock, stock and barrel, or recreated as model villages at a discreet and antiseptic distance from the great house itself. If you ever travel on the road from Blandford to Shaftesbury, the A350, you will be aware just after a Stourpane of a hideous kink in it, in which you have to go all the way round a particular park. This, I believe, is the gentleman responsible. He was the owner of Steepleton Park, and funnily enough, I came across his portrait in the National Museum in Copenhagen. But the removal of what had considered to be rights of way through parkland was very much a symbol of this increasing privacy of the estate. Long walls, screening woods, held the general public at a distance, while reinforcing a kind of group privacy of those gathered by kinship, friendship, or bonds of service. The great seat of power, once open to all and sundry, seemed to be veiled now, a greater mystery. This is Charborough Park, and its surrounding walls, I think, opened 2 or 3 days a week. For 200 years and over, it's been the home of the Drax family, who represent the parliamentary and landed interest in Dorset, as they have done for a good long time. Just in case you think the country had made any social progress in the last 200 years. But yet, when I study Pride and Prejudice with my students, they're often very surprised that Lizzie Bennet visits Pemberley with her aunt and uncle Gardner to view Mr. Darcy's house entirely uninvited, something which causes him great embarrassment when he turns up unexpectedly. In the chapters about their trip to Derbyshire, there is a list of the other great houses that they visit on the way. Yet all the great houses of the day, Blenheim, Chatsworth, Holkham, admitted wandering visitors almost as soon as they were completed. The polite tourist who, if of gentle bearing, might apply to the housekeeper for a tour of the house in the absence of the family, was a very common phenomenon. And it was quite likely that they'd be admitted, because most of these people, by intermarriage, owned probably three or four such houses, as well as being absent during the London season. Motcombe Park, near Shaftesbury, was the Grosvenor's, what we might call the Grosvenor's country cottage, if you like. Now this gentleman, Horace Walpole, an author and transformer of a modest Middlesex house to this, Strawberry Hill, kept a series of notebooks between 1759 and 1771 full of the surveys of the collections in houses that he visited entirely on that basis. About 200 of them, long before the invention of the National Trust and the Historic Houses Association. And he visited places like Audley End, Woburn Abbey, Castle Howard, Knowle in Kent, Melbury House, Sherburne Newcastle, there, Hatfield, Kedleston, Longleat, Clandon Park, and Wentworth Woodhouse. So collecting your country houses is not an entirely modern phenomenon. But in a sense, as the local communal hospitality of the great house of the 15th and 16th century began to pass, they were revalidated by a different kind of openness to considerably less costly and demanding visitors, maintaining a human connection to a wider public, while within the houses, the increasing realisation of habits of privacy and of domestic space became the norm. Well, another way in which the country house became available to a wider discerning public was through ventures in publishing. And one of the most famous of them all was the Vitruvius Britannicus, which is a great engraved collection of country houses that ran from the early to the mid to late part of the 18th century, initially sponsored by Lord Burlington, who's trying to get people to jump on the bandwagon of his particular kind of architecture. Now, the historian Lawrence Stowe reminds us that from the Renaissance onwards, there are gradually developed social habits that, he says, distance the self and the body and its functions from other bodies. Customs which spread to the middle classes over time, and I would argue, continue to spread. Those of us of a certain age will recall traipsing along hotel corridors to a shared bathroom. And we might now be alarmed and discomforted by the absence of an ensuite when we try and make a booking. It's thought necessary nowadays for every child to have their personal room in a family home, even long after they cease living there. Now, Stowe talks of two types of privacy. The primary privacy, urination, defecation, and copulation, to put it delicately. And secondary privacy, the reading and writing, and personal reflection and devotion. He draws our attention to the fact that Protestantism and texts in the national language of a devotional and later wider kind did increase literacy significantly. So the small chapel, the private study, became much more significant. And so these shifts in attitude are going to necessitate shifts in architecture. Now, allegedly, men are more robust about the business of urination. And I'm sure there are those of you who are exercised on a feminist basis justifiably with that old and now redundant sexist custom of the ladies retiring after dinner while the gentlemen remained in the dining room. But there was one reason for this, which is largely overlooked. I was looking at a plan of the of the furniture in the dining room at Kingston Lacy, and there was a sideboard, and one cupboard was labelled very clearly with the letters CP. So I wondered and wondered and wondered, and then it came to me. That side of the dresser was where you kept the chamber pot. So after dinner, once the ladies had removed themselves, the gentlemen could unbutton and carry on their conversation and their quite considerable drinking in older days. Half a pint of port was nothing to be sneezed at. And remember, this is in a day when even a fairly advanced large house might only have two loos in it. There is a story of a 19th century ducal Scottish castle where the gentlemen would meet in the hall after breakfast with their copies of the Times and walk in their tweeds to a bridge across a burn not far away from the house, which had some wooden privies arranged on either side of it, where they would converse and make themselves comfortable. Then they would button up, go back to the castle and continue their day's shooting. There was also a move away from communal dishes, of course, and cups at meals. These remain now merely ceremonial, in loving cups and, still, the chalice at mass. Now, the separation we have noticed from the general public was similarly mirrored in this time with the seclusion of servants into areas distinctly their own. And as Marc Girard makes clear, in what he calls the moral house of Victorian times, in both areas of the house, the service and the family home, there was a very clear separation of married, of unmarried adults of either sex in areas as far away from each other as possible, with access regulated by senior household members at the head of each significant junction. But it's not that great houses or palaces were not without private or more secluded places, because quite often all of these buildings had long enfilades or sequences of rooms where access was controlled, sometimes by footmen, sometimes by guards if you're in a palace. At the very far end of the axis of honour, that was the most private place, the bedroom, the boudoir, the study, and you had to be very, very special indeed to get there. In fact, at Blenheim, when it was built, the Duke had his wing of the house, the Duchess had the other, and if they wished ever to be maritally intimate, it was difficult to see how almost everybody didn't know about it. But there we go. Another thing you might know if you know Kingston Lacy well is near the remodeled entrance hall, there is a kind of estate office come justice room. Now, the justice room in houses was another indicator of the power of the landed gentry, because so often they were justices of the peace, and it was quite convenient, and they did their work and passed their judgments on their own premises. There were no independent magistrates' courts. And so that would often be quite near the entrance hall. And so what struck me when I was thinking about this, I mean, I grew up in a 17th century cottage, and we had to pass through every room to get to every other. I used to have to go through all the family bedrooms to get to my own. We had to go through all the rooms downstairs to get to the sitting room, and so on. But then it struck me, it wasn't just a cottage thing. In the 17th century, whether you lived in a palace or a cottage, the corridor did not exist as an intrinsic part of domestic design. Now, Longleat was one of the great late 16th century prodigy houses. And I'm just going to share with you a couple of ground floor plans. That's Longleat as built. These areas here, that's the hall, there's the screen's passage, that's the dining hall, and those are the rooms that were all open to public and communal access. The place was remodelled in 1809. Keep your eye on the top of the slide. After the 1809 remodelling, there were huge areas that were given over to service. The corridor was created round there, which restricted movement through rooms, and the only room which had multiple public access was probably the hall. There's an extraordinary drawing in of private space. Wilton, which is built around a courtyard, a similar style of house, had a two-storey cloister inserted in 1809 to create that same kind of privacy, so that the rooms could be serviced without the servants constantly going through all the others. Montacute House, which some of you may know, a huge and rather wonderful building. This is its original entrance front, full of glass, a bit like Hardwick Hall. And here is the remains of the dining hall. You can see the screens corridor here. But now it's a place for family portraits. So that's the room we've just looked at. But to give a privacy to the rooms on either side and upside, they built a corridor. Or rather, they stole a bit of an earlier Elizabethan house which was demolished, called Clifton Maybank. Clifton Maybank, being earlier and less grand, was only two stories high. So that's the Clifton Maybank corridor, which was inserted onto what was then the back entrance of Montacute, and that became the front. What you'll also spot is that there's something different about the staircases on that side and in that side. This is the big grand family staircase. That's the service staircase. And although the windows are the same size for harmony, that staircase is infinitely narrower and much steeper than the grand progress you have up the other one. Fantastic public palaces in the Roman style. This is Kedleston in Derbyshire. Dealt with the idea of family privacy in a different way. That is a cross-section through the central part of Kedleston, with rooms modelled on Roman temples. And that's the main entrance hall, and that's part of the rotunda just beyond it. And if you look at the plan, those are the two rooms you just looked at. There's the hall, there's the saloon. These clearly are all great rooms of display. Their way of dealing with family privacy, and it was done by William Kent in Holcombe Hall 40 years earlier, was to have a kind of mini house which the family retreated to and lived in, so that they only used these things for their court, for their entertaining, and so on. By the 1880s, when our local remaining palace, Bryanston, was conceived for the Portmans by Richard Norman Shaw, he had thought it would be a good idea to make his plan incorporate a central corridor all the way through. You still have the same enormous public rooms of display, although that dining room was in daily use. You might think a little extravagant, perhaps, for a family of four. but the principle of having the most private rooms along the outer edges of the axis of honour was also true, although the service wing was interesting in being opposite a room, opposite a wing, from which it didn't actually differ significantly externally. So those two wings actually match, although that's a service wing and that's a public wing. And that is the main central corridor at Bryanston, which goes from one Venetian window to another. But it does allow for a rather impressive central space. But a house is not just a family centre and a retreat. It's a place we go out from and return to, a place in which we assert our presence even when we're not there. It's the result of our commerce between our home and the world in which we act. Power and wealth often increase the sizes of houses, but it also increased mobility. And as I said before, mobility between multiple homes. And nowadays it seems to be the sort of megastar who has sort of four or five houses, who has to jiggle with the existence between them. But mobility was also a form of education. And from the late 17th to the mid-19th century, the education of the next generation in noble families was the Grand Tour. And they spent a good deal of time, sometimes up to 2 years, maybe more, abroad, with a kind of tutor and guide. And they brought back continental manners and habits. These were often looked upon with considerable suspicion. Designs, fashion, and bought a considerable amount of painting and sculpture. They were the first souvenir hunters in human history, I suppose. This total immersion on the continent, of course, led to an easy mastery of French and Italian language, as well as French and Italian building styles. And as today, of course, the travel experience was blended into the home. They brought the fashions back, which made the outside of their houses look like the places they'd just come from. The Italian style began to be more obviously popular in Britain from the early 17th century. Wilton's famous garden front, attributed to Inigo Jones, probably with Isaac de Caus as well, comes from the study of Italian precedents. Stowe head, designed by Colin Campbell, again is an imitation of a Palladian Venetian villa. So you have an English gentleman copying an Italian architect who was building sort of farmyard palaces based on Roman models. It gets quite complicated. And a stairhead over time was expanded on either side. So the original small delicacy of it was something that was somewhat lost. And as time went on, the Greek fashion became more dominant. This is the Grange near Alton. I'd always wondered why the Greek revival came after the sort of classical and the Roman revival. And then it dawned on me, of course, that Greece and southern Italy were the places aristocratic travellers went to later because they were too far and too dangerous to reach in earlier times. As their freedom to travel with increasing safety and better roads took them to more distant places, they brought back more distant architecture. There was some mild attempt at an Egyptian style, but I'm glad to say it didn't get much beyond clocks and door frames. Okay, so we have, by the early 19th century, the reaction to travel being reminding us of places of light and sunshine. But at the same time, those of a romantic disposition rather liked the fantastical possibilities of the Gothic. This house, which sadly no longer stands, was William Beckford's Font Hill Abbey, a fantastical place he designed by himself. He was often absent and didn't keep a close enough eye on the builders, as a result of which the rather magnificent tower collapsed twice. On the second occasion, he gave up and demolished the rest of the house, and he had a vast fortune. And it's fair to say that the Gothic here is seen as a flight of fancy, as in this rather wonderful building, which you can find in North Wales, which is Penrhyn Castle by Thomas Hopper, about 1820s to 30s. It's kind of Norman imitation castle. So this looking back to medieval and earlier models for inspiration is in itself interesting. We're turning away from the pagan, from the classical, to a style which is associated with the triumph of the Christian. Now, one of the reasons the Victorians built so many churches was simply because by the middle of the 19th century, huge numbers of English churches were almost falling down. Why was that? Well, that was because the prevailing style and fashion was for the classical. Gothic was considered ancient, barbarous, nasty. If you wanted to build a church, you could probably get away with something like St. Peter's and Blandford Forum, because that was nice and elegant and classical. If it was Gothic, you just let it crumble. But as there is a shift towards a kind of religious revival in Victorian England, there's a re-embracing of the Gothic. And the re-embracing of the Gothic included the house as well. It except became so prevalent, this embracing of castle style, that someone described it as the monstrous practice of castle building. But if you go inside Penryn, you can only wonder at the interiors. I have no idea what country that might have originated in. Now, there was another trend as well, in parallel to these two, brought about by travel. And that's an affection for what I call an Italianate style, based on the Italian palaces of the High Renaissance, well known to travellers. And even in the late 19th century, Florence and Rome and Venice were hugely popular with Victorian travellers, even though in the 19th century you stood a good chance of dying of malaria during a visit to Rome. It didn't keep people away from the place. But the best local example for these Italian palaces are Osborne House in the Isle of Wight, designed largely by the sort of almost nauseatingly talented Prince Albert, and more familiar to us, Kingston Lacy, which was an enterprise undertaken by a very knowledgeable patron and an experienced architectural voyager, Charles Barry. William Banks actually met Barry in the Middle East, while they were both on architectural and archaeological exploratory tours. Barry was a wonderful draftsman. Some of his sketches of houses in Italy are extraordinary fine. But Kingston Lacy speaks particularly about our argument about presence and absence. Now, William Banks, gentleman on the left, Charles Barry on the right, he inherited what was once a glorious mansion. It was designed by a man called Roger Pratt, although everybody said it was by Inigo Jones. Architectural history wasn't a very exact science in the 19th century. Basically, if it wasn't attributed to Wren and it didn't move, it was by Inigo Jones. They were wrong 3 times out of 4. Anyway, Roger Pratt's mansion, of which we have this rather nice drawing, was rather fine. But it was fussed about and reordered by nervous owners. The cupola on top was taken down. The entrance on the other side, which you can see here, that lovely flight of steps in the half basement, that was got rid of and replaced with a rather kind of meagre portico on the stable side of the house. It wasn't the house it once was. And when William finally inherited in 1834, at the age of 48, he just let rip, he just got going. He spent a lot of time educating himself in English architecture as well. His travel, his imposition of ideas, initially was very, very English indeed. And he implored Barry to go and have a look at some of the houses he had looked at to help the remodelling of Kingston Lacy, perhaps particularly Lee's Court in Kent and Cole Hill. Cole Hill was another Roger Pratt house. So what he did was he encased the whole in stone and gave it an entirely new exterior expression. The south side has this sort of Belvedere-style attic window, and on the east, an almost Venetian-style water gate. And in the interior, he imposed a magnificent staircase. And in the southwest corner, at long last, a decent-sized dining room. And that came about by removing some of the minor rooms that had originally existed. The library is the only remaining example, one of the smaller Kingston Lacy rooms. But a way into this remodelling disaster struck. William John, for the second time, was arraigned for what we now call gross indecency. He'd been around for it in 1830 and managed to get a whole load of character witnesses along who said he was a decent chap and wouldn't dream of doing such a thing. The court believed him. In 1841, he'd been foolish enough to tell a few fibs about what he was up to, said he'd only gone into Green Park not to follow the guardsmen, but he wanted to look at the rearrangements of the park and the new architectural items in it. Yes. And he gave the name of one of his own servants. That didn't go down very well with the law. And he realised in the end that he would have to flee the country, which he did in September. And he remained outside of the country, everybody used to think, until he died. But he did come back on, I think, two occasions. Now, what he did in Kingston Lacy was to continue in his absence through letter only, through simple correspondence from all over Europe, more concentrated in Venice in his last 8 years, letter after letter after letter, managing the continuing development of Kingston Lacy. So he had his staircase, but he commissioned an extraordinary group of statues of his ancestors from the Italian-born French sculptor Baron Carlo Marichetti. And there you can see King Charles sitting down, and quite rightly, his great ancestor, brave Dame Mary, who held out in Corfe Castle against the parliamentary forces, and earlier on her husband there, the Chief Justice. So those were commissioned. The staircase itself continued to receive shipments of Bianconi marble, of alabaster, and of these exquisite carvings done by a man called Pegrassi, which he commissioned to replace some rather crude 17th century plasterwork that was there. And that's kind of Grinling Gibbons done in stone. They are absolutely stunning. And he got a great deal of kudos from commissioning local Italian artists to do things for him, rather than just nicking stuff and sending it home. He provided work for sculptors and also for model makers, because he had a lovely little model made of an ideal country house, but that's a different subject altogether. And you get the sense of the effect of this house and all the richness of it. This is particularly interesting because that rather nice door provides us with the evidence that WJB went back to Kingston Lacy before he died. Because the archive, the family deleted nearly anything compromising in it, but they missed a letter in which he complains that someone had clobbered that door and dented it with a coal scuttle. And he said it wasn't designed for keeping coal in that closet on the stairs, and could they not do it again? But he would never have known that if he hadn't been back. He would never have been able to complain about the wrong type of white paint used on the frieze in the redecoration of the saloon if he hadn't been to see it. And his correspondence takes him to Paris for the autumn of the last 2 years before he died. Now, I suspect he knew he wasn't terribly well, and Paris was not a difficult launching point to get back to Dorset fairly discreetly if you knew the right kind of people. One of his great triumphs, of course, was the sighting of the paintings he collected somehow. People don't ask too many questions about it. When he was touring in Spain and Portugal during when the Peninsular War was raging, so 1811-12-13, and his friend, the Duke of Wellington, he wasn't then the Duke of Wellington, was there doing his military magnificence. And he brought back all these paintings, but created this wonderful room. Now, that wasn't complete by the time he was exiled in 1841. One thing he did do was give the background of the rooms this extraordinary leather wall covering, which showed a real kind of cultural awareness. Because leather wall covering, you can find generally in all of the areas of the Habsburg Empire, in Spain, in Austria, and in the Austrian Netherlands. And it was an ideal historical foil for his paintings. And there are lots of letters about how to varnish this, how to match them, how to look after the leather, how to stretch it. I mean, he was a very exacting micromanager of things. Would have driven, well, probably did drive people he worked with fairly mad. He also designed, you may think it's a bit fussy, but there is a certain beauty to these, three sets of doors for that particular room. And the designs on the panels of the doors are his own work. And in the archive in Dorchester, you can come across the watercolour originals, and you can see how nicely they are reproduced with some sort of subtle changes of colour because of the gold background. And the shadowing that the executing artists have put on them actually gives a rather splendid depth to some of these. And he also designed and sent the materials for niches in the saloon. The purple and white marble there is actually, I think, has been sawn to only a quarter of an inch thick because it wasn't quite enough and it was quite rare. And I think one of the pieces got damaged in transit, so he was in correspondence about that as well. And on the left here, that's the fireplace in the dining room, and that's the half design he came up with. Kind of envisaged there in a sort of pink marble, it was actually yellow in the end, because that's all they had. He also had copied Venetian wellheads. Those were nicked by aristocratic tourists in Venice, right, left and centre. He got some credit for having some copied and sent home, rather than purchased from rather dodgy antique dealers. Perhaps the loveliest story I know about him inserting his presence into his house and home is one about him going to a pet shop in the Palais Royal. If you know the Palais Royal, just opposite the Louvre, it's a huge series of arcades. Now, in the mid-19th century, it had lots of shops in it. And there were pet shops there. It was well known as a good pet shop corner. And he went to the Palais Royal to get a tortoise before it hibernated, because he had an idea that bronze tortoises would do rather nicely as footings for a set of four reddish vases he'd already managed to accumulate. He had an encyclopedic knowledge of his property and artifacts. Baron Marichetti, the sculptor there, probably looking rather worn out by William Banks' requests, was kind enough to model the tortoise and to cast it 16 times. And if you go to Kingston Lacy and you walk along the garden terrace, you can see these 16 tortoises that he had made from the single one he carried in a little bag off to his sculptor and wrote and told his sister about. It's one of the most charming kind of brotherly letters. It really brings the human scale of architecture and design fast home to one because of the intimacy of that tale. Had he not been absent, his constant assertion of his presence and his continuing continental experience would have been far less intense. And while I know some people find Kingston Lacy a bit overdone, a bit too fussy, it is a testimony to his yearning towards his own home. And the house itself, almost in some of its elevations, seems to yearn back towards him, yearning, as it seems to here, to the warm south. But yet this business of inserting family, inserting ideas, inserting artifacts and collections is not just the property of the rich and the powerful. We all do it. This is my late mother-in-law's achievement wall in her house, covered with pictures of her children when they graduated, poems written for family occasions, commissions in the army, and so on and so forth. I'm just going to give you two corners of our own home. Part of a room of mine, and you know, this is just as it is. Flags of Cornwall, Norway, and Greece in the top, places I love and places I've travelled to. Collections of books edited over time. Here's my collection of Tolstoy, which came from my aunt's house in the United States. It's an edition published in 1903, for which I still have to cut the pages when I read it. And to get it there, I just threw out all of my modern paperbacks, because I knew I could easily replace those. That's my father's Dickens. In one corner, there's a picture, my favourite photograph of my own father that I took. There's a cartoon someone did of him in 1937. And there's his mother and himself and his sister in about 1912. There are random books there. A tiny elephant I was given when I had German measles at the age of four. And various other things. I mean, we personalise our space very particularly. If I just simply show you a fragment of our sitting room. That lamp came from my mother's house. Those two floral decorations are from some close friends who ran a shop sort of specialising in those kind of things. This seated mercury came from my aunt's house in America. But in our travels across Europe, we've both seen versions of that in German museums and in public spaces, because it's a very popular sculpture. It's there in different sizes and different versions. Those two coasters are imitations of medieval floor tiles coming from, where was it? Morven Abbey. That's me on my first day at school, and that's a picture of us on our the day of our civil partnership. So we all do the same things. Our journeys and ourselves are imprinted unmistakably on our houses. And I'm now going to share with you something really very odd. In the summer, we went on a trip up the coast of Norway on this rather old ship, launched in 1964. But I couldn't help noticing that we just can't get out of this habit of family associations, even with inanimate objects. Because in the cafe, along the wall, were family pictures of the sister ships of the same boat. On another wall were the ancestors of the same line from a previous era. On the staircase going down to the cabins was testimony to all the ports the vessel actually docked in. We just can't stop ourselves doing it. On the tour, up the coast, we stopped at a city called Bodø, where there is the Norwegian National Air Museum. And the last section of it is dedicated entirely to the package tour. And behind this aircraft, just here, is a shelf entirely full of the kitschiest souvenirs you could ever hope to set hands on. But they make the point that the package industry gave people access to foreign places, foreign experiences, new styles, new things that they wanted to include, that they wanted to bring home. So when we're not within our houses, we're carrying with us the places we are and the places we've been. And I'd suggest that in a peculiar way, although I suppose I'm sure art history purists will want to scream at me when I say this, there's an almost exact equivalence to coming back from Spain with something like that, or something like that. Or a family picture that is like this, or like this. And that Zoffany picture of the Woodley family in Kingston Lacy actually speaks volumes about the gendered nature of mobility as well. Look at the static nature of the women there. Look how the men a yearning out into the wider world. The boy and father focusing on a butterfly out there, the dog running out after a hare, the women standing round an urn the most lively of all, a little girl who is sort of stretching out, pointing to a kind of distance that she perhaps already somehow instinctively knows her brothers would have a much wider scope to perform in than she has. So, wherever we go, we lug the intimate and humanising changes that make a place a home. We enrich it with our travelled experiences. The liminal space of our homes, our doors, our gateways, are perhaps the most important parts of all, because it is through them that we make our own home an intimate and special place ourselves. The home, the path, the road, the doorway has always fascinated artists. This is a Dutch from the Wallace collection. So it doesn't really matter whether your pathways and your porch and your entrance to your home looks like this or like this, whether your roads to them have been planned to look like this or this or this. Mm. It is our tracks in a wider world outside the home that bring to architecture of any size its human scale.
Well John, that was absolutely wonderful. Thank you very much indeed. So we do have time for any questions. Yes, if you'll just wait for the mic to go around.
Thank you. I'm a grand designs fan, and I love a big white cube that's modern glass. Probably you'd hate it. But given £10 million, what would you have? Would you buy somewhere? Would you have somewhere custom built? What's your dream?
My first career choice was actually to be an architect. And I had some rather dodgy career advice and thought I couldn't be. So I designed my own house. And actually, I mean, Dave knows, I've got a drawer at home of houses I would love to build for myself if I had the money.
We should have shared those.
I'm still waiting for him to build it.
Crowdfunding.
Well, that would be a bit selfish, I
think. But what style?
It was Georgian on one side, on the interior courtyard, it was Gothic Revival. Have my cake and eat it. Okay, John.
Thank you, John, for a wonderful talk. Really enjoyed that. Social housing. I've always been mystified by the fact that the skyscraper in Liverpool was rejected by the occupants of Liverpool, but they exist quite benignly down in Bournemouth. Is there any explanation for that you can offer?
Possibly. I will float a theory. When councils built blocks of flats, they did that in order to move communities to what they believe is improved housing. The single story, the two story terraced house and the street had its own associated community. Which included the street space as well, and the alleys and so on behind. But there was that was integrated. What happened was, I think, is you got people into the blocks of flats that piled them one on top of the other. They immediately lost that sense of communal wider space. The sort of the service space within a block of flats is relatively small. It's the emergency staircase and lift access and not much space beyond that. So there isn't the talking room. Because they had that other experience, they would immediately have come into those buildings and felt that they lost something quite fundamental. And if your public space for your kids and so on is 50, 60, 70 feet down there, again, that sense of the community being there to keep an eye on the kids, you being able to sort of pop an eye out of the window, the door being open, a safe space being there, that's gone too. So there's probably a tradition of, as people were replaced, they were inheriting homes from people who were not satisfied with it. So a tradition of discontent with the architectural space, I think, probably followed. Now, in Bournemouth, the places built were on a larger scale. I think there were people who voluntarily came into them and purchased them, possibly, at a time in their lives when a greater degree of privacy and quietness was actually welcome. So I suggest there was a contentment in a move into a block of flats in Bournemouth. Whereas if you've been uprooted from a terrace street where there's a very real community, it was a very different thing altogether. I mean, not to say that communities don't form in blocks of flats. There are always management committees which you can join to annoy several other people in the building as well. But people do follow naturally activities, and quite a lot of newer build have communal spaces for members, particularly the kind of buildings that are designed for people of retirement age, to generate sort of communal space. So I suspect that's the reason for the difference in reaction to blocks and tower blocks.
Sounds entirely plausible.
There was no chatting over the garden wall, was there?
No, not at all. And actually, even on the balconies, the balconies in flats are quite strictly denoted. If you're on the train on the way into Waterloo, around the back end of some of those 7 or 8 storey sets of buildings, I think they're probably Peabody buildings, there are long, long balconies on the side, and that did allow a kind of suspended street and for people to talk and chat and lean and put out washing, and there is a kind of community there which links a whole lateral floor in ways that simply doesn't happen in a much, much taller block.
Yes, we've just come here, and then Karen.
I detected a slight ripple amongst all of us, I think, when you showed the interiors of those minimalist apartments and offices. I find it just blank. There wasn't a bookcase, there wasn't anything disarranged, there was nothing on the walls, there was no splash of colour, there were no family photos, there was no cat or dog. Nothing brought back from the holidays or the travels. And I don't know, it seems completely soulless. A lot of modern minimalist living, to me, is almost unlivable. However, there's a spectrum, and I'm pretty sure I'm at the other end of it, which is where you've got so many keepsakes, I'll call them keepsakes, and things that matter to you, that you can hardly move. And it isn't just cosy, it's cluttered. And I think it's quite hard to achieve a balance in one's own, perhaps in the great houses as well, because you showed us some country house interiors which were extremely cluttered, and we know what the Victorian interiors looked like, really overstuffed in every way. So what would your advice be about finding the balance to the human space where we've got our own wonderful personal keepsakes and memories and the people that we know and love and the places we know and love? They're there, but there's also space to manoeuvre.
Well, that's been... Yeah, I mean, it is a problem. We twice contemplated moving because of stuff. And we just put a wooden shed in the bottom of the garden and put the stuff in there. The first time was when my aunt died and there was furniture and stuff from her house. I didn't want to get rid of them. I didn't want to move either. And then when Dave's mum died, and material from her house, including a piano and all the books we'd stored in her house, never thinking that one day we'd have to read them and comment
on them. I knew I would have to one day. Yeah.
So what advice would I give? The advice I'd give you is stick with what makes you comfortable. I mean, if your very being is wrapped up in everything you've got there, leave it. It's fine. It doesn't matter. If there's anybody who comes to your house who thinks it's too cluttered and it's a nuisance, don't ask them again. It's as simple as that.
I've always admired William Morris's dictum, have nothing in your home or your house which is not either beautiful or useful. And I look at some of my stuff and I think, gosh, I don't think it's either.
But there is a certain Puritan streak in that dictum, isn't there, really? We've all got things that are ugly and totally pointless in our homes. And I think... that's what makes them human. I have to say, in all fairness, that obviously the pictures that I selected for minimalism, I chose with an agenda, didn't I? I did choose those that were most obviously bare. They had clearly been photographed by people who photograph rooms professionally and were deliberately uncluttered to make the point about their modernism and minimalism. And I'm sure that people living day to day in a modernist house, in a minimalist house, probably don't tidy everything away until the photographer comes or whatever. So I think we probably all do it. But minimalist houses tend to be designed with very subtle places in which to bung material you don't want people to see, to hide it away. As I said, like you, it leaves a feeling of coolness and not inhumanity, that's unkind and unfair. But a coolness and a distance from your sense of the person who lives there. I think that's fair.
There's a wonderful story about my mum's achievement board. Kind of embarrassing, really. You know, and it just grew and grew and grew over the years with all of our kind of degree certificates and all the rest of it. And one day, my niece was sitting at the table looking at this wall, and her father, my brother, was sitting next to her. And she was looking at all of these graduation photographs, and she said, "Dad, how many degrees have you got?" Because actually, there was one of me on the wall that she thought was my brother. So she was looking at them and thinking they were all my brother's photograph. Anyway, I've got a few people waiting. Karen, and then Simon, and then we'll come down here. Okay, so Karen first, and then Simon at the back.
It was very much related to what the other ladies just said. But maybe a different slant on things, because I think one thing that really bothers me is I have friends who decorate and redecorate and redecorate and throw out and recreate these minimalist environments, the IKEA junkies. And I find it quite disturbing. And I wonder, is it because people don't have confidence to make their mark and don't kind of value the quality of something rather than the quantity and the newness and have the latest and greatest? Have we kind of lost our way in terms of being able to appreciate specialness and quality? Or does that sound terribly snobbish and, you know, up my stuff? That's my thought.
Yeah, I mean, the number of shops where you can find old furniture now has diminished hugely. They can't sell it for anything because, well, it's too big for modern houses and no young people want it. Maybe if I could suggest this as an alternative, there may be a different kind of honesty in your friends who redecorate. Maybe that is their sense of themselves, that they wish to be constantly up to date. And that's them honestly saying, look at me, this is me. This is the new me, this is a slightly different me to 5 years ago, or however often they decorate. They're enjoying that. I suspect somewhere they've got drawers with their children's baby photographs, or at least I hope they have. I think it is very much the influence of the modern era, where everything has to be up to date and so on, yes. I think you get to a certain age, you hang on to things. There's also, there's an interesting essay I read, which was about the way children so often reproduce the decorative styles that their parents had. And I don't think that's true anymore. But a survey on material culture in the United States was putting side by side pictures of people's parental home and their own home and matching the decorative detail. And that was interesting. Probably less true today.
Just working.
Yeah.
Before I start my question, actually, I can count the story about the achievement award. I have been to my local MP's surgery on several occasions. He doesn't have an achievement wall. Every wall of his surgery and the passageway going up to it has photographs of him with the Queen, him with Maggie Thatcher, in an RAF jet fighter pilot's uniform. I guess MPs are MPs. My serious question is actually, because we've touched on human flourishing seems to be intimately connected with the built environment. And it seems that some people think that clutter is something we enjoy, other people not so sure about it. But have there been any comprehensive studies really on the impact of the environment on people's happiness, their contentment, their social interactions? And what lessons does that give us for good design in future?
I mean, most of the studies that I've read tend to concentrate on the relationship between houses and the exterior space and the proportions between them. Less on interior space and the way that's organised. Obviously, it is a factor, the amount of space you actually have. And the complaints nowadays about the quality of modern British building in relation to the space that is allocated to the individual. Family homes are, and bedrooms are felt to be too small and so on, because the profit motive means that you use as little material as you can to produce the maximum profit for the area. There are interesting studies in relation to what used to be council-sponsored housing that was on, they tried different experiments on lower levels with two or three integrated areas with pedestrian access, viewable recreational spaces for children that weren't at too great a distance. So there are studies on that, but I think I have recently read widely in this, but I haven't seen studies which talk about the physical interior space beyond the material culture within it, like the bits and bobs we're talking about, and the contribution that makes to the reaffirmation of the self by what you have in front of you, reminding yourself of your history, your connections, your travels and your values, I suppose. Mm.
Phil, could you come down here and...
Simon. Yeah, thanks very much. I find it very interesting, the bit of your talk where you were saying how between the 16th century and the 18th and 19th century there was a new demand for privacy, separation from servants, invention of corridors. I found that social history very interesting. Somebody who's been around an awful lot of National Trust houses, I find I get depressed by the sort of sameness of what one would think was a wonderful pattern where you have an English garden, noble trees, a bridge, a lake, and then, the long gallery of the ancestors and some flowery furniture in the rooms. But it's a kind of rural idyll separating off the country gent or aristocrat from the rest of society. And I mean, do you think there's almost like an English neurosis in the great English country home that meant by the time we reached the 20th century, our leaders and everyone that we aspired to was on the wrong planet, you know?
That's interesting. You are right about the accumulation of wealth that these kind of mini palaces represent, and the sort of separation that they seemed to imply between the English country gentlemen and the people around. But that's not entirely true, because the existence of the English country house and its estate, and the involvement of the resident family quite actively in the maintenance of the estate, and in fact as the sort of social service department for that small area. Okay, there were cruel employers, there were dreadful landlords, but there were lots of very, very benign and very good ones. Mm. And the English country...
If the money is maybe coming from slavery, from trade, from factories, from the dominions, there's something false about it. It's not coming from their estate farm, from the home farm. That they're sort of acting a part, which is seems a bit unreal.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I mean, if you go around Harwood House in Yorkshire, the family fortune there did come from slavery, and they hate anybody mentioning it, even today. But fortunes were invested in the land because the land sort of gave them a return on it. But their presence on their estates for a certain part of each year, and their continuing connection with them, as opposed to the French aristocracy, who centre themselves on the court and remained there and neglected their estates and left them to the control of often rapacious agents. Now, that difference, some historians claim that the English country house is the reason we didn't have a revolution here. At the same time, although we'd had our revolution cut off our King's Head in 100 years before. You are right. I mean, there is, and again, it's sort of that image of the benign aristocrat with a kind of real genial concern for everybody around me is constantly polished up by TV series and so on. But I think there was a certain amount of self-interest in not letting your housing stock decline, not letting the people on your estate resent you. Because that was your pool of labour. You couldn't call on it from anywhere else, really. So, yes, obviously, there were profiteers, there were slave owners and so on in the history of the English country house. But they also did do the business of being, many of them, being responsible landowners. So I could share lots of stories of nastiness with you as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Going back to minimalism now, I'm wondering if it's partly because a lot of people's stuff is virtual. So all their family photos and their holiday photos are on a cloud, and they don't buy books, they read e-books, and they've got a whole display of their social world by just looking through Facebook and so on. So the actual stuff doesn't really matter so much.
I think the tendency to hang on to things. I mean, how many of you actually print off pictures that you've taken from electronic files? I suspect if we did all papers, yes. So the tendency now is, you're dead right, it is not to clutter. And the uncluttered house will probably be more of a possibility to get any classic book online,
and we don't receive letters, so we don't get them, but we might get some emails.
Yes, absolutely, yes.
We've seen a whole range of housing, housing here. I'm wanting to ask you if you're willing to give an opinion on the estate that in west of Dorchester was initiated by somebody whose home background is Buckingham Palace, high-grown, and sort of decided how people should live in Calvary.
Well, I mean, Humphrey is interesting. I mean, there are a couple of things that I think you can probably say about individual buildings within it as imitative of earlier styles, because they're all revivals. They're Regency revivals, Jacobean cottage revivals, a lot of classicism, because the Prince of Wales has a peculiar fondness for classicism and classic. The modern classic revival architects, not just Leon Creus, people like Quinlan, Terry, and so on, and the Venturis. I mean, in all fairness, one of the most beautiful pieces of classical revival and what's called polymorphic contextualism in architectural terms, the Sainsbury wing at the National Gallery, where the National Gallery's architectural features slowly fade into the new building. And it's done with an extraordinary sort of delicacy. Now, as the Poundbury itself, there are individual buildings alike. There are individual buildings which are actually quite mind-numbingly ugly. Town planning is a difficult thing, to bring something into fruition from nothing, and to try and create a way of life. My sense in walking round Poundbury is that it hasn't yet worked. That there is, you don't see enough, that the sense that there's a kind of communal life there doesn't strike you. Mm. You barely see a soul on the streets. Yeah. There's still a lot of space dedicated to cars and the parking of them. And I'm not sure that there's enough weight there to support all these little shops that are here, there and everywhere. I don't know. I think over time, once the Duchy of Cornwall kind of finally can let go of it, it will evolve in different ways. But I know the kind of restrictive covenants there are on stuff there, the properties there, which would make it very difficult for things to change. So that perhaps it's an example of too much control. I suspect individuals who live there very much like the houses and homes and the gardens that they have, because they are, as individual objects, very, very agreeable and built to a very high standard with good materials, by and large. So I don't know. It's a work in progress, because, I mean, really, it's not even half completed yet, is it? I think I look at the master plan that there was. It does have a slightly Disney-fied feel, it has to be said.
You normally refer to it as Charlieville.
Yes. I'm not alone in
that. Paul? Oh, and then we'll come back to you, Charles.
Thank you, John, for a good speech. This business of collecting things, I personally feel that we've all got different levels of kleptomania. And I mean, I'm the worst offender. I never throw anything away. And because I look at it and I think, oh, I can't just destroy that. I can't throw it away. It's got a beauty in it. I start studying, even if it's something very basic. But I don't think it runs in families, because my eldest daughter is an extreme minimalist. I find minimalist properties, they're not cosy. There's a hardness about them. But she's got rules, her discipline's incredible. If she hasn't used something for 12 months, she throws it away. And she sticks to it rigidly.
I hope she visits you from time to time.
but I think generally, most people have got this sort of varying degrees of kleptomania, and we collect things around us. And I think that's one of the reasons that we seem to collect so much clutter. And I'm the world's worst. I'm like you with your shed. I put another shed up and I fill it up. And then I think, oh, I'm lacking space. And if I build another room on, I've